Welcome on campus. In this short video, I'm going to show you how the instruments work that we use to measure the net radiation normally in the Hubsel. Well, these instruments need to be portable so we can walk around with it, and that's why we put them just on a stick very easily to carry around. How we carry them around, I will show you later. But when talking about net radiation, we have to consider that there are four terms of that. You know, we have shortwave and longwave radiation. Shortwave radiation comes from the sun. Longwave radiation is emitted by the atmosphere, by clouds, and also by the Earth's surface. And when we talk about net radiation, we talk about the balance between what's coming in and what's coming out. So we have in total four terms: longwave in, longwave out, shortwave in, shortwave out. And that means that if you want to measure that, we have four instruments. And that is exactly what we have here. Well, one of the covers already fall off. We have these covers to protect our instruments when we carry them around. But of course, when we're going to measure them, we have to take them off, because we cannot measure anything. Well, here we see we have four instruments, two looking upward, two looking downward, but the downward looking sensors are exactly the same as the upward looking ones. So if you watch here, you see that they're exactly the same. Well, then the question is, which of these two instruments is measuring shortwave and longwave radiation? Well, this is the shortwave radiometer, this is the longwave radiometer. And the main difference is the difference in the cover, in the filter that we use. Because this glass-like cover is transparent for shortwave radiation, and that is also visible radiation. So the fact that we can watch through it also means that it's transparent for shortwave radiation. And this filter, on the other hand, it's not transparent for shortwave radiation, so all of the solar radiation is kept out, but it's transparent for longwave radiation. Well, as I said, we have four instruments, and as I said, this shortwave radiometer is in principle the same as the one that's down here. But that's only in principle, because if we go and try to find out what's the relationship between what it measures and the voltage that comes out, you will see that the calibration factor is different. So, for instance, the calibration factor is given here, and the upward looking sensor has a sensitivity 14.15, and the downward looking sensor has a sensitivity 14.33. And that's all in watts per square meter per millivolt of voltage that comes out. So they are identical, but not exactly identical. That means that if we measure with these instruments, we have to take into account that calibration factor. Well, that's actually something that is done for you when you get the data. So in the end, when you get the data, it's already calibrated for you. Well, there's a voltage coming out of this instrument, but you're not need to measure that voltage. That's done for you in the data logger that I will talk about later on. There's one thing that we should take into account when we look at the longwave radiometer. The problem with longwave radiometers is that they emit longwave radiation themselves. And that means that what they measure is not the incoming longwave radiation, but it's the net effect of what's coming in and what they emit themselves. And so if we really want to know how much longwave radiation comes in, we have to correct for the amount of radiation that it loses. Well, that amount of radiation that it loses depends on its own temperature, and that's why a longwave radiometer also includes a thermometer, so that it measures its own temperature. And using Stefan-Boltzmann's law, we can determine then how much longwave radiation emits itself. So in the end, we get five signals out of this package of sensors. Four radiation signals plus the temperature of the longwave radiometer. So I introduced the sensors to you, and now the question is, how do we gather the data? And as I said, we get voltages for five signals out of the sensors. So I could send the students into the field with a voltmeter and then note down all these things, but there are better ways to do that. And for that we have a data logger. Well, this is the data logger that we use in the field. And a data logger is actually nothing else than a combination of a voltmeter, or actually a number of voltmeters, with a small computer. And so the computer tells the data logger when to measure and actually what to do with the data, and then the data are stored. Well, the connection between the sensors and the data logger is made with a very simple plug, which connects all of the sensors at once with the data logger, so that goes quite easy. And actually, the data logger immediately starts to measure. And that means that even now that we don't gather any useful data, it's already measuring. And to ensure that we only store the useful data, we have this very nice switch. And so this switch tells the data logger to actually store the data. So as I said, it's measuring now, but we don't care about these data. But once we are in the field and we start our measuring round, then with this switch, we can switch the storage on. And then if we want to stop the measurement or if we want to interrupt it, halfway a transect, for instance, then we switch it off, the data are not stored. And then if you go back on, it's switched on again and the data are stored. So that way we can control which data are stored, and actually the data set that we gather only contains useful data. Well, let's see if we can see anything here, anything useful. Well, actually we now measure shortwave incoming radiation, and I can immediately tell the numbers. Then of course I should hold my my sensor nicely horizontal. And what do we see then? We have a global radiation now of 872 watts per square meter. But wait, I said that this thing measures voltages, but I see a flux of watts per square meter. Yeah, well, exactly. That's what we have the calibration factor for. So the calibration factor is included in the data logger, and it converts the voltage that it measures directly to a flux in watts per square meter. So the data that you will get in your data set will already be fluxes in watts per square meter as you would like to have them for your surface energy balance. That also means that, as we saw, the calibration factors for each individual sensor is slightly different, that there is a unique combination of this set of sensors with this data logger, because this data logger knows the calibration factors of these instruments. So they belong one-to-one together. As I said, we store five signals, so apart from the four radiation fluxes, we also store the temperature of the long wave radio. But that's not all, because we also store the time. Actually, ideally, of course, you would like to know exactly in what field and where you did your measurements. In that case, we would need to attach a GPS to the measurements as well, but we don't have that. But what we do have is the internal clock. So we know when the measurements were taken, at what hour and what minute. And with that, if you keep your logbook, then you can deduce, okay, we did the measurements at that time in that field, and by that we know which measurements belong to which field. Actually, in the Hubsol practical, we use two sets, and these two sets measure at different fields. So we need to know the set number, so we have the set number one and set number two, and in combination with the time of measurements, we can deduce which measurements were taken in what field.
Okay, let us do some trial measurements with the setup as we have it here. So we have the sensors looking upward and downward, and on the data logger we can see which values it's recording now. So let's have a look on the screen of the data logger. Well, here we can see that at this moment we have about 850 watts per square meter in shortwave radiation incoming, and you also see that it's updated every second. The shortwave outgoing radiation is about 120 watts per square meter. And we also have the long wave terms in and out. And the values that you see here are already corrected in the sense that the temperature of the housing has been taken into account. The values that you will get in your data set do not have that correction yet. So they only have the net effect of the long wave radiation, the net effect of what comes into the sensor minus what it loses by its own emission. Then also you see that the temperature of the sensor is recorded here. It's 23 degrees Celsius about. And of course also the battery voltage of the data logger, because if we are carrying around instruments, we also need to take care that the energy supply is going all right.
We walk around with the instruments in this way to make a transect through a field. So you walk along and then you measure over different surfaces. And, well, mainly the downward looking sensors will see different things. Of course, the upward looking sensors will see more or less the same things in terms of clouds or no clouds, etc. There are a few things to know. One is that when you walk, the instruments start to swing. So although we try to make it such that it doesn't move too much, there will be some swinging. So especially when you have clear sky conditions with sun like today, you might see some variations in the incoming radiation that is due to the fact that the instruments a little bit swinging like this or swinging like this. And the other thing is that, of course, we need to take into account that the downward looking sensors don't see our own shade. Well, this way it works pretty well because the sun is there and so my shade is behind me. But now if I would walk a transect in that direction and turn around, then of course, if I'm located this way, I will be measuring my shade. So in that case, you need to make sure that the measurements are taken in such a way that your own shade is not taken into account. For instance, by walking like this, because then the shade is beside me and not below the sensors. Well, in this way, we can make transects of a few hundred meters through a field and measure, well, if you walk at about 1 meter per second or even less, you have a measurement every meter, because the sampling interval of the measurements is 1 second. So if you walk by 1 meter per second, just 1/2 meter per second, your measurement interval will be about 1/2 meter or 1 meter for each individual sample. Well, those are the data you're going to analyze, and other people worked hard in the sun to gather those data for you. It's now a matter of trying to understand what's happening in the data.